Welcome to the .NET user group. If you are in the wrong room, still hang out and have pizza with us and learn some code. I am Tim Franklin. I'm the Supreme Chancellor of the group, and I appreciate you all coming out, especially with the bad weather. But a big thanks especially to Paperwise. Not only are they presenting tonight, but they're also sponsoring all the food and got some cool bottle opener things and some other cool stuff. So appreciate it very much to Paperwise. So I'm going to go with a couple of announcements real quick, and then we'll talk about a couple of job openings too, and then we're going to get started with the presentation. So, who here is not familiar with the Meetup? Any hands? Okay, some other people kind of get the general idea. So Meetup.com, that's where we post our upcoming events. There's a bunch of other user groups that have events too. You can go there and see all sorts of details coming up. You can use the mobile app, and then you can get alerts on your phone whenever a new meetup is posted and other cool stuff too. So definitely check it out, and you can see about the other groups too. But in particular, there's also a calendar that we have from a bunch of different groups that put together. This is basically, it's FWDSGF, Forward Springfield. And so that's the web sort of address, FWDSGF.com. And this is basically all of the different user groups and all the other community events in the tech community here locally in Springfield all combined together into one calendar, so you can always see what's going on. You can see that we have a bunch of different user groups. We have the .NET one, obviously, that's us. We have the web devs that meets on a Wednesday of the month. There's a tough Python user group. There's a PowerShell user group. There's a bunch of different user groups. Women in Tech, AITP, a lot of different groups out there. And so we all, you know, the tech leaders try to keep in touch and kind of understand what's going on and promote each other's groups and stuff too. So a lot of collaboration there. There's also a really cool hackathon that we do every year now as a group sponsored by MATA, which is Mid-America Technology Alliance. It's called Hack for Good, and so we have another one of those coming up later this year. So we basically get together for a weekend and have teams of people that build an app for a charity or other nonprofit that needs something. And so we have a couple of cool apps that we've built so far and looking to do another one this year. So a lot of things going on there. All right. So I work at Gravitate, and I know that we have a couple of different positions open, including one for business intelligence implementer. And so that's something that if you're interested in BI and stuff, then you know, feel free to come talk to me. We have a software engineering position open as well. I think we have a project manager position too, so a few different things there. I know Paperwise has some, so I want to give them a chance to talk about theirs in just a second. Does anyone else know of anything in the industry that they want to share, if they have their company has spots open? Levi?
Mostly Serious is looking for a senior engineer.
Senior engineer, okay, great. Mostly Serious, so it's a local company here doing the design and dev stuff, right? Okay. Anybody else? Yeah, David.
Money Tree Lead Systems.
Full stack dev. Okay, great. So a lot of things out there. And feel free also if you know positions or if you're just looking and you want to, you can post stuff on our Facebook group or on LinkedIn. We have LinkedIn group too, and then we have Twitter and stuff too. So feel free to post whether you have openings or if you're looking for something too. And then Paperwise. So like I said, they're sponsoring tonight, and they have at least two positions open. Somebody want to talk about that? You got a second to? Yeah.
Well, just basically, I think we've got an implementation position and a developer position, but we're always looking for talent. So
yeah, very good. Yeah, we got a few different Paperwise people here today too. Again, thank you for coming out, and thank you for sponsoring very much. And be sure to talk with them afterwards and say thanks too. So tonight we have Jeremy Newman from Paperwise, and he's going to be talking about graph databases and Microsoft SQL 2017. So. Okay. Go ahead, Jeremy. Oh. I should mention real quick, we are recording this, and it's going to be live on YouTube too. So.
So
you can check it out later if you weren't able to make it.
You're good there, anywhere from there to the projector.
Okay. Right. So here, okay too?
I can turn it.
There we go. Yeah. Supposed to have this pulled up already.
I
So that talks about SQL 2017 and you know, the graph extensions that they've added recently. And so I started on this journey because of my coworker. Is this the wrong? Yeah, okay. Because of Jim back here, a coworker had introduced me to graph databases, and I think Neo4j originally, but they have added graph extensions to SQL Server, so that's kind of what prompted this. But so I don't know if how many people are familiar with graph databases, but they're essentially, you know, akin to object graphs, you know, in programming. Nodes with edges, that your nodes contain data, your edges can also contain data, and it allows you to represent highly connected data and relationships much better than relational tables. Or much easier. Nodes can have multiple different relationships. Basically all over the place. But the properties and such on the nodes and the relationships like describe, you know, everything that you want. Basically, I need to quit saying that word. I say it too much. So graph query languages are normally semantic, and there are a bunch of different languages out there. The big problem currently is there's no one standard language for querying GraphQL amongst the different platforms that are out there. There are different flavors. I chose to go with GraphQL, and I'll talk about it in a minute, but basically GraphQL allows you to, it's not graph database related, it's basically an API for your API, opposition to things like REST, or a technology like REST, which is an application, I guess more of a philosophy. GraphQL is centered solely on querying data and only getting the data back that you want. So it's a really good choice for querying graph database data. The cool thing about it is you can tie together many different disparate data sources. You can pull data from, you know, the mainframe, flat file, SAP, wherever you want, but you can query it all in one cohesive model. And you go to one endpoint to get it. So in that way, it kind of gives you a facade over the top of all of your different data sources. And provide some other cool functionality, the ability to have fragments and things, reusable queries that you can inject, you know, or bits of queries you can inject into your larger queries and reuse. That's basically just a list of some of the most popular graph database platforms out there. There may be one missing, so don't call me on it. Part of the reason why we opted to choose SQL Server 2017, it was, you know, training related, and then also support related. You know, you never know when, you know, you choose a technology, especially if it's from some unknown company. They may have been around for a few years, but they may not be there in a year or two. So it's always a safe bet to pick a, you know, a bigger player. Originally, we actually started out with our own graph database implementation sitting on SQL Server, using, basically self-referencing tables in SQL Server CTEs to do recursive queries, which got us pretty far, but it was one of those kind of things that over time to maintain it with all of the emerging graph database stuff out there was going to be a lot of time and effort. So we were waiting for the graph extensions for SQL Server to get out of the Microsoft Research program, and they did introduce those around the first of the year. So working with graph tables and edges, graph nodes and edges in the SQL Server is just like working with regular relational tables. It really, they are extensions to the engine, and they're built right in. So you know, you can index them like any other table. Some indexes are added for you. Whenever you create node and edge tables, you can't see it there, but you get some extra columns. So you can see over here, there's an edge ID, a from ID, and a to ID. It's basically like a big cross-reference, but it's automatic. Those tables store JSON information that relate your edges to your nodes and what have you. The biggest problem at the moment is that if you want bi-directional edges, so the big thing, you know, with graph databases is edges are usually either direct, unidirectional or bidirectional, so they can either, you know, go one way or both ways. With SQL Server, they're one way, but you can query them backwards to get the effect of having a bidirectional, and that's part of that you can, you know, bake into whatever data layer you put on top of that to do your querying and what have you. But that's just a standard. Select some order. So instead of having to join all of those tables together, I can relate them together, matching them by edges, and I can have however many I want. You probably don't want to add too many. And if there's any errors there, you can just tell me later. But a lot of these examples are just baked up, and I didn't actually run them, so the running code will be at the end. So there are some pros and cons to using the SQL Server graph stuff over other graph platforms. And a big one that's on the list there are the transitive closures, which basically gives you the ability to query for any number of edges, on a particular node, and get back everything. That's not supported, although you can do it yourself with queries using SQL Server, the CTEs, the Common Table Expressions. There's also a number of other things that aren't supported. Really matches the only keyword at the moment. I'm assuming, that they're gonna support more features in the future. But that's something to look at if you're choosing SQL Server, or if you're looking at SQL Server over another graph engine. Then the next big thing that was on the list is GraphQL, which I talked about earlier. And GraphQL is, you know, basically just an API for your API. It allows you to create a model around, you know, an existing data model you might have. So for example, we use Dapper for the database layer stuff, and then we're able to use a graph library that's out there to wrap that up and only expose certain properties and what have you to the GraphQL layer. Those properties are also deferred. The execution of those is deferred. So for instance, if you query something and you don't select a particular property off of an object, and it's a lazy loaded object, it's not going to get loaded up front. The other, introspection is another big thing, and you know, I mean, there are a lot of frameworks out there for restful services, like Swagger's a big library to use for describing your REST API, allowing users to see what's there. One of the nice things about GraphQL is that's baked into the engine. So whenever you build your schema, you can actually use introspection to ask your graph server about, you know, what methods and types are supported, and then mutations as well, which are essentially the writes, the creates and updates, and what have you, any data mutations. But all that comes in introspection, and I'll show you that a little bit later as well. That was fairly short. I didn't describe everything, but I didn't want to bore you with all of the details. If you want to read through every slide, you know, feel free to do so. The big thing I wanted to get to was just the code examples. So it's not, you know, production ready code. It's not super awesome. It's functional, and it kind of just shows a small example of using all the technologies together. And so, and it might be easier to look at this stuff than it would be to look at the slides. So there's some test data here, a person node, a restaurant node, a city node. Can you not see it?
It's pretty tiny.
More? Do we need to go?
Can I turn the lights off? Is it going to be too dark?
No, don't do it.
Actually, that's a lot better.
Yeah.
Consensus,
yeah.
Awesome. So, yeah. The test database just has some, you know, example data in it. People, restaurants, city. Some edges, likes, friends of, lives in, located in, and then, you know, some of that test data. Down here you can kind of see there are the node inserts, the edge inserts. Kind of funky looking there. But if you'll notice the select the node ID, where, so that's, you know, even though there are node IDs on those columns, those are generally used internally only. So you don't want to write application logic using those columns. You can use them, you know, for inserting, updating, and deleting, but generally just to, you know, tell SQL Server what you want. So as in this case, we set up the edge here, and we inserted the from and the to, selecting the node ID from the person that we wanted and the restaurant for that particular edge. It's pretty much the same way, and you know, if you're going to insert extra properties, I believe down here we've got some, maybe not. One of these had a rating on it, but I don't see it. I apologize for the scrolling. There are some example queries at the bottom, but we'll run this thing and I'll kind of show you what we can do whenever we query using GraphQL. So I mentioned the introspection. This root query is the query object exposed in the GraphQL library that I'll walk you through here in a little bit. But if I click there, it's going to give me a list of fields. There, you know, basically with GraphQL, you kind of have to shift your thinking. You're not calling, you know, methods to return data. You're querying a model. So, you know, for instance, if I want to query people, if I want to query this field, I'll say I want persons, and I want to get their ID and their name. And if I only want that, that's fine. I'll get back a list of those guys. I can also add parameters and what have you to these, but the example doesn't show the parameterized stuff. I can also query a field off of that pulls from an edge and tells me where these people live. And the other thing, it pretty much the sky's the limit. There are a lot of different capabilities, but GraphQL lends itself very, very nicely to querying graph data, no matter what underlying system you're querying the data from. And again, we can go deeper into the graph if we want to. Kind of a brief intro to how you might build a GraphQL query against something. There's a lot more at GraphQL.org. You can go read. It goes really deep. There are a ton of features and capabilities. This doesn't even come close to showing GraphQL off, but it does kind of relate how it might be useful for querying graphs. So some more of the introspection there. You can rename things. There are also, if I could type, I'd be doing good. There are also a lot of other ways to limit the data that you're getting back with different actually, I can't remember if they're called, I think they're called, Anyways, brain's lost that one. We'll go though, let's see here, kind of check out some of the code. So, the GraphQL stuff itself is fairly simple, and you're really just exposing your model as a query, and then the web API controller used to run this just takes the query in and executes it using the execution engine. You have to create graph types to map what you want to expose through your API, and then once you've done that, it's pretty much automatic using reflection behind the scenes, but it is very quick. We've actually been using it on quite a bit of data for our projects, and the queries are very fast. There was a case with one client that where we, query 10,000 some employee records, and it comes down in like 500 milliseconds. So. And on the data side, essentially we're just querying the database for the node data using Dapper. You can use whatever you want, really. There's a kind of an example of querying an edge. that might make everybody go eek, but it's an example. It's also not the best example, but it will do. And the controller for this guy is pretty simple. We're using a library called GraphQL dot, or called graph.net, GraphQL.net. Basically executes everything for you, has a parser out there that adheres to the GraphQL .org standards. So it's probably way too much on GraphQL, but it does provide a, you know, in the absence of SQL Server actually having a query language of its own for querying graphs outside of just regular SQL, this gives your applications a way to ask for only what they want back from the graph and get only that back, as opposed to, you know, having to have a static set of data that they get back, and maybe they only use one or two fields out of that data set. With GraphQL, you can query the database stuff and you know, ask for those two fields and only get those two fields back without having to create more endpoints or models. On the Angular side of things, I don't know if you guys care to look at that stuff, but on the Angular side of things, we pretty much use the GraphQL there.
Can you hear me? Can you zoom some more on this one?
Yes, yes, yes. Maybe. Let's kill this guy. So we're using a library called Apollo to query our graph data from the server, and it kind of wraps up all of the GraphQL stuff for you. It's pretty easy to use, and they've got versions of Apollo for pretty much everything: Vue, React, Angular. Their bindings, or, you know, individual libraries. I'm not sure. I hadn't really looked into how they're built, but I know they've got a version for all the major frameworks out there. And it makes it really easy to I may actually be looking at the wrong project. So yeah, inside the client side code, essentially set up your GraphQL query there. I chose to do it this way because I didn't want to mess with Webpack. But there are Webpack loaders for the GraphQL stuff as well. And so, essentially, this guy just uses the query and uses Apollo and says, hey, give me this stuff back. And I'm not using anything fancy to display it. But over here, I'm pulling the stuff and shoving it into some nodes for display purposes. So tell if it's readable or not.
It is taking forever. There it goes.
Sheesh. So, I probably spent more time on GraphQL than I needed to, but it's been a major thing when it comes to querying, ease of querying graph data from SQL Server. So, and this is just a little force-directed graph example using the data that we were just looking at in the database. Nothing big, but showing, you know, how that stuff can be used to pull the data all the way from SQL Server into your app. And so, I don't know if you guys want to look closer at any more code or not. Have any questions, anything specific you maybe heard or no?
What was the query you sent to the SQL Server to get the data back to us?
The you want to see the actual SQL query that got sent?
Yeah, so from what I understand, you take and make a GraphQL query against your web API and that goes to the GraphQL library.
Yeah, and that actually happens through Dapper. Those queries are actually the ones that we were looking at a second ago. But do you want to actually see you want me to fire up like Profiler and look at those, or are you wanting to see the code, or
I would just like to see, I guess, some more examples of how that would
look
in SQL.
Ah. We could look. We've got this guy here. There are quite a few more out there, but I mean, essentially, there's not much to the match other than chaining. You know, it's basically node and edge chainings. We can jump in here and actually write some queries if you want. Yeah. We wanted to see what data we got. I can't remember everything that that thing sets up. So we've got cities, we've got lives in, located in, restaurants. So I think restaurants uses located in. So if I wanted to query, you know, restaurants. Essentially, it looks like we're gonna do an old school join, you know, with a where statement, but you know, your edges are normally in parentheses, and then you have an arrow to specify the direction. So here there are your, well, that is not readable either.
options to change to the grid? That might be nasty. Yeah. I don't normally look at them that way. You guys probably can't see that at all. It's not much better. Scrolly, scrolly. But yeah, there's the an example of the JSON data stored in the node column or the edge and node columns, the metadata columns that tie everything together. And pretty simple, but the engine will do the joins and what have you based upon that metadata in the background. So. There's the IDs, and these are the node IDs, not the ID column that we specified. So those are going to be, if we select it against that table. And I could spell, that'd be good too. And control plus is not working. Yeah, there you see the IDs in the node ID column. And if you look at the edge columns, then you're going to get the same thing there, pretty much, for the IDs. Along with your that's pretty much all it does. Other than that, they're just regular tables. The engine treats them differently, and they've added a new keyword. The other big thing I think that I like about this, as opposed to a lot of other stuff, the other graph platforms, there are a few out there, I think, that allow you to mix relational data and graph data together. But SQL Server probably being one of the more popular. Database servers out there. There tend to be a lot of developers who, already know SQL, and hopefully some of the other, relational database guys will catch on and add some extensions, to other stuff out there. And there may already be some that I don't know of, but that's something to check around for as well. But mixing the graph and the relational data together kind of gives you the best of both worlds, in that you could add existing graph functionality to a system you already have, or like we did, we have a mix of those two paradigms within the same database. Is that where you want?
Yeah, that was great. How would you apply a filter, like if you want to say some constraint on cities or located?
Same way. So this, pretty much, if I wanted to say, and
say under cities. It's pretty much the same way you would normally in you know any other system. Should be some MOS in there, but I may not have reloaded the database, and apparently I don't know where the delete key is. Yeah, so let's do, I think they may all be Washington in here. Oh, there's a MO. It's just, really? That is interesting. Oh, I bet you it's probably because there's no edge. I probably didn't assign MO to anything in my test data. So let's find something else. Could actually go. Pretty much, you know, the same stuff applies. It's just an extra keyword. I haven't really done a whole lot of, you know, try grouping, you know, any kind of aggregation, but I have seen some stuff out there. So you should, you know, essentially, I think what happens behind the scenes is match gets turned into joins, on those metadata columns. Oh yeah, and then we do that in the code here. You kind of can't see it. The Dapper extensions make it look really weird, but right here we've actually got a SQL parameter getting passed in. And in some of the code that we have for a product we're working on now, we actually build these match statements dynamically based on some different criteria. And then we're, you know, using the parameterized queries and what have you, but I don't know. For the most part, there's really not a lot to it, using graph data in SQL Server, but, you know, again, limitations, but you can get quite a bit of, I think, extra, I guess, dev speed. Instead of writing joins for everything, it gives you the ability to not have to have hard relationships between everything. Makes a development much quicker, and you can, you know, if you need to, you know, have new relationships, they're pretty easy to add. Another thing, you know, it could be seen as a downside, but one of the big things is there are no edge constraints, so there's nothing out there to limit.
You know, in other words, I could insert anything I want into those edges at the moment. There's no constraint to say this edge has to go from this node to that node. But, you know, like anything else, don't shoot yourself in the foot. A lot of times I try to name the edges so that they convey what they're supposed to be used for. And in some, you know, there are a lot of cases also where you can use the same edge table to represent the same relationship between multiple different node types. So, you know, tags would be a good instance of that particular case. You know, if I wanted to tag every one of those, a person, a location, with some extra data, then I might add a tag node table and a has tag edge to allow me to attach tags to everything. So in that case, it'd be any kind of node to a tag node. So that's another thing you have to be wary of. And just make sure that you know, whatever you do with the back end, you try to constrain it on your own. I'm sure they'll be adding some of that stuff later. But on the other hand, it does mean that there's also nothing to get in your way. So kind of one of those things you would have to weigh, and you can't, like I said, you can constrain it if you need to at a higher level. Indexes for those node columns are automatically created. If you don't create them, SQL Server will create indexes for you on the metadata columns. And then all of the other columns, you can index like normal, just like you would a standard relational table.
Other than indexes, is there any other best practices for joining in this way? I mean, if you like friend of a friend of a friend, that could become potentially slow to perform. Is there best practices or anything else you've found?
Well, no, I mean, as far as best practices, no, I mean, when you're building the match statement, you pretty much are limited to the level of edges that you put in your match statement. Like I said, we're building them dynamically, but in a lot of cases, we're just doing that to mimic the ability to have bidirectional edges. So we'll spin them around depending on what we need. I would imagine the same things would apply as if you were going to use common table expressions to do recursive queries. But I mean, if you indexed them well, so far we've not seen any big problems. And like I said, we've got some data out there where we've got over 10,000 employees tied to, into an org chart, although there probably, there are 10,000 edges out there. So each employee has an edge pointing from their particular employee node to an organizational role node. So we've got that going on, and the query time seems to be pretty decent.
Other than profiler, do you have any other way to see the execution plan or to compare?
No, we could use profiler and check it out.
I'm just comparing it mentally to something, it's very different, but the MD framework where you kind of write another query and it writes a query behind the scenes for you.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah. Well, okay, so the deal is like if we're executing code from here, that's actually what gets executed in the engine. I don't know if it would really show you that they were joins or not. In the case of this code over here, that actually is the code that executes. And Dapper's just a micro ORM that sits right on top of ADO.NET. But
to raw SQL joins is something that SQL
Yeah, it's built.
Yeah,
I mean, we're using Dapper as a micro ORM, and that is the raw, that's essentially the raw query that gets passed right there. Well, not essentially, I mean, it's passed exactly like that, and then we've got, you know, a mapping function to tell Dapper we want you to return these guys. But in the case of the SQL Server stuff, Match is built right, it's built right into the engine, so I would actually guess that if we run Profiler, and we actually look at this guy, we're probably going to see if it responds. So yeah, I mean, it comes right across as Match, and that's all you get. I don't know if you can see that down there. And you can't. That's great. But yeah, it basically, this inquiry came through there. And as for Dapper, it's probably one of the quickest ORMs out there, written and used by Stack Exchange. A lot of people out there actually are mixing, either using Dapper on its own, or in some cases they'll use Entity Framework and Dapper together. They'll use Dapper where they need, performance, really good performance, and they'll use Entity Framework where they don't care. They want it to be easy. Although I find Dapper pretty easy. It supports a lot of stuff. Something worth looking into. There's a lot of dynamic capability there, mapping capability. There's several add-on libraries out there for it. It's just a pretty good ORM, pretty performant. I don't know if there's anything else we wanted to explore. What it would basically be is an RPC call from your web API, unless you're going to use REST or something like that to, you know, in which case, you would have to build, the model for your REST library. So this stuff here is all just Dapper and C# and the GraphQL stuff. If you wanted to query that, you'd be making a get to a URL and asking it for, a person. In my case, I'd return, Jason. But you'd end up with a number of controllers out there probably to pull your data for you. But the thing I like about GraphQL is you don't have to. Unless you have a very, very large system, and even if you did, I still don't think you would necessarily need multiple endpoints. But you can have one endpoint essentially and run everything through that. You're just saying, hey, here's my query, give me my stuff, and it goes and executes the query and gives it back to you. I don't have any performance stuff or statistics out there, but I do know that GraphQL was something that was actually started internally at Facebook, and they got to a point where they thought it was so cool they released it to everybody, and I'm pretty glad. I think it lends itself very nicely to querying graph data in general, but you can use it to pretty much query anything you want from anywhere. You can go to graphql.org. And like I said earlier, there's a ton of stuff
that's possible. Along with, you know, aliasing and fragments I mentioned before, which give you the ability to have, you know, reusable chunks of fields that you can embed in your queries. You can specify those in line. So in the case of, in this particular case, that fragment's in line, but it doesn't have to be. It could actually be part of your schema. And tons of other possibilities. Argument passing, that's pretty common as well. And then I was trying to remember, there's a special construct for being able to specify properties internally as opposed to like parameters at the high level, at the top of the query on the root field. You can specify parameters actually inside of your query directives. So, and it comes with a few out of the box, but it gives you a way to filter at a lower level in your query. This stuff goes really deep. There's definitely no time to cover all of that stuff, but you know, if it looks cool, you might go to graphql.org and check it out. There's a ton of stuff going on in the community, and so this app here is pretty cool. Graphical, it's a UI that allows you to run queries against your server, and as long as they're, you know, spec compliant, then it doesn't matter what kind of GraphQL server backend is behind it. And also, you know, allows you to set your headers and stuff if you need to. Has some strange quirks. Every once in a while you get some weird stuff happening. But it's pretty easy to get used to. You can also embed those. There are a lot of people, I think IBM actually has that graphical web app buried in some of their apps out there on the web. I haven't looked into why, but I've noticed some links out there recently. I thought it was kind of neat. But there have been a large number of people that have been flocking towards it. It seems like it gains more and more momentum as time goes on. For, did you say visualization?
Yeah.
Well, no, I mean, you. Not specifically with GraphQL. I mean, I think it might be a decent way to provide a facade over, you know, a set of data to be able to pull data that you might want to visualize. But yeah, there's really, I mean, you can't. You could use it to build a query language or a query API for your visualization if you wanted to. I think the nice thing about that is you could actually set up, you know, somewhat like a DSL. Maybe you build a model that represents what you want to, you know, be able to do, or add particular data for different companies, what have you. You know, the model really depends on you, but you could, you know, you might get data from this third-party client over here and data from over here, but you can tie it together in one cohesive model, possibly. You may not want to do that, especially if there, you know, some of that data is potentially sensitive, then you might not want to put them in the same endpoints. So that might be another, you know, use case for keeping endpoints separate and having, you know, separate authentication for each query endpoint. But
For GraphQL? GraphQL, so I did talk a lot about querying, but GraphQL actually has support for, they're called mutations, and it's essentially, you know, anything that changes your model. And really, there's not a lot of difference between how it actually executes a query or a mutation. The main thing is that how the communication happens, a lot of the GraphQL clients out there will use queries and mutations to trigger events in cache. So in some cases, like if you could actually build a query that did an insert if you wanted to, it would be a very bad practice. What you would run into in a case like that is that a lot of the GraphQL clients out there, their cache would not know that you actually inserted something because it thought you queried something. So it would capture the results that came back from your insert and shove them into the cache. That kind of thing. Most of those allow you to, change the caching level to network only and don't cache anything, that kind of stuff. But that's essentially, when it comes down to it, really, it's more of a, just a way to categorize your queries or your, what you're executing on the model, whether it's a query or a mutation. Essentially, they are identical except for what you do inside the method, the resolver for the query. So. I think I'm done unless anybody's got any more. Probably said way too many times. But.
Well, we appreciate being here. Great content, great presentation.
Thank
all right, let's give another round of applause and thank you to Paperwise too for the food and everything. All right, so a reminder, fwdsgf.com is the calendar, and then there's the meetup site as well. I've got a couple of things to raffle off. We got a sign up sheet being passed around, so make sure that you get on the list there. And then I've got two different licenses from JetBrains that we can give away. And so you can pick whatever software package they have if you win. And you get a free activation code, you go download it, put in the code, and it works. And so they've got all sorts of different products. Some of you might be familiar with ReSharper, or they have Writer, which is the new one that is kind of similar to Visual Studio. They also have PyCharm and WebStorm and C-Lion. Anybody not sign up yet? You can't win if you don't sign up. That's kind of how it works. So. Jason, you on the list?
Good.
You're good? Okay. All right. So use my little random number generator here. And we'll give him a round of applause, but just see me afterwards if you win and make sure that I can read your email address, and I'm going to forward it to you here in just a minute. Number 13, Mike West. All right, brother. Okay, so I've got one more to give away to you, but I'll go ahead and mark you down here, Mike. Number 11, Junior Levy. Or Levy. Yeah, there you go. All right. So one thing to note is that coming up soon, they're going to start locking the doors for people coming in after 7 o'clock. We will have somebody here to let people in just for security reasons. They don't want the doors wide open for people to come and go. So if you do need to exit the building, make sure you take your phone with you and your keys. I'll make sure that we walk everybody out whenever we're done, but there's no rush. So. But starting next month, that's what they're kind of the new thing. So, I'll have my phone with me too. And so if for some reason you need to be kind of back and forth, you can go throughout the building if you need to, if you need to take a phone call or whatever. But if you need to go out to your car, you need to let me know so I can let you back in. Otherwise you miss the rest of it. So, feel free to hang out, talk to Paperwise.